So most of you are familiar with the Carnegie African Diaspora Fellowship program. It's was funded by Carnegie Corporation of New York, and it's of course administered by us here at IIE and in conjunction with Quinnipiac University, which houses the program's visionary, Dr. Paul Zaliza, and he oversees an advisory council that makes all of the decisions for the program that aren't administrative decisions. So we send different fellows to six different countries across the continent, Nigeria, Ghana, Tanzania, Uganda, Kenya, and South Africa. So far, we have selected 100 fellows, but it's promising, as some of you know, that there is residual funding, and we're going to be able to fund even more fellowships in our initial funding cycle. And we are pushing toward the renewal, as some of you know, that Kat and I have been busy preparing the renewal documents, drafting those documents the last couple of days. So we are hopeful that the funding will continue. So this is kind of to give you a little bit of an overview of what's happening in the program, and I know some of you from CAIS especially, CAIS know this already, but I wanted to of course share it with some of our newcomers today. So I would like to start by introducing our guest today, Dr. James Momoh. He is a professor and director of the Center for Energy Systems and Control at Howard University. We were able to eat together, Dr. Reese and Dr. Momoh, and I asked him if there was anything else that I need to say about him, and he said, no, that's all you need to say, because they'll learn about me whenever I get up there. So I guess I'll go ahead and turn it over for him, and then at the end of the presentation today, we'll give you a little time for Q&A about his project and any of his other work. So thank you, Dr.
Okay.
Momoh.
Thank you. First of all, let me send greetings from Nigeria, as well as greetings from Howard University, my home university where I teach and do research. Again, this is a great opportunity to come back after a long trip to Nigeria to give feedback in terms of you send me, and I have done what you asked me to go do, and I am back. So it's good that I have this opportunity to report back to you what you expect to hear, which is, what did you do? How did you go? They say, welcome back home. So indeed, I'm back. Well, my name is already mentioned. I'm a professor at Howard in the Electrical Engineering Department. I used to be the former head of department for that department for over 11 years. After that, I went to the National Science Foundation as a program director, where I worked for about 4 years directing programs in the Electrical Engineering Division at the National Science Foundation in Arlington. And since then, of course, I've been back at Howard, been doing my research and engaging some of my African colleagues in the area of power engineering, systems engineering, and computational intelligence, and of course, helping researchers who are younger too than me to do well. I'm a Nigerian by birth, and of course that's why I'm a diasporian. And I'm not only an American citizen, but I'm also a fund member of the Nigerian communities of scholars, where I have done, been a member of the academy, as you have been told. All of those letters just suggest that I'm a fellow member of the Academy of Engineering in Nigeria, and a fellow member of the Academy of Science in Nigeria, and of course a fellow of the IEEE in the US and international. All of that is just to say that I'm very close to the academics, as well as the industry in the power engineering area, even in Africa. In the last few several years, I have organized a lot of conferences that has helped to bring the US and the Africa in the sub-Sahara together to address the issue of relevance in the energy sector. So today is also another opportunity to let you know that you've selected someone who actually believe in Africa and believe in the exchange. Even though I grew up here, went to school here in the US, over 40 years almost now, I've been migrated to this great country. So let me go on now and quickly just let you know that the Carnegie ADF Foundation, as you know, the terms of reference for that grant is for us to go abroad for 3 months. I couldn't give the 3 months at this initial appointment. I was able to do 1 month right away because of other obligation I have at Howard. I couldn't do the 3 months at a stretch. I hope I could do the difference later on. Again, the grant allow us to go, and you gave us some enumeration, and the host country actually did most of the other collaborative funding. You provided the ticket. Thank you very much for that. It came at the right time because I was a little broke. So again, they provided the accommodation and the feeding, 3 square meals, until I told them I don't eat 3 times a day anymore. You know, I probably gain weight going there. So I also have very nice people to work with here. I have students, I have professors, and in fact, as I go on, you will see that it's like a home university automatically, all of a sudden. It became a place as if I knew about that school all my life. So I want to say very quickly, I was to help in many things. I couldn't do all of it because of the short time, because we had to write the contract twice. I was to help in the curricular development. I was to help in research. I was to help them in developing outreach programs. I was to actually do so many things in the academy that normally you would do if you are a full-time professor at FUTA. FUTA means Federal University of Technology in Akure. There's also a FUTO, Federal University of Technology in Oweri. There are many Akure, but Akure is FUTA, so let's make that clear. They are located in the western part of Nigeria. I will discuss that very quickly. And of course, you will hear more about history of FUTA soon. I was there for like I said, for about 32 days, basically. That's myself. I think I was to wear a Nigerian dress, and it got messed up, so I had to throw it away and just put something else, okay? So that's myself, but looks like I'm in the States, right? I really didn't want to see this there, but that's what you see. That's my colleague. The award required me to have a partner. Dr. Adegoke Melody is my collaborator. In this case, he is the one who stand by me night and day to ensure that whatever I went there to do was a success. Plus, a very strong team that he put together called students. And of course, a leadership of the university called the vice chancellor. Like instead of using president in America, they use the word vice chancellor. The VC is the alpha and omega, the one who directs the university. But we have a very good VC at FUTA who really provided a first class host for me. The very first night I got there and they put me in this guest house, they assured me everything. There was going to be light 100 every day, every minute. Indeed, it happened. They assured me there was going to be internet service, first 24 hours every day. I got it. But then I have a little table. I said, I need a big table. I need to work here all night long. And the VC went straight to the office and asked them to give me a table from his office. Wow. I got a first class treatment all of a sudden. So I could walk all night long. I could jump from my bed straight to the table to work. That's how it all started. That's Dr. Melody. He's the associate professor, a very good gentleman, very committed, trained in Moscow. And of course, it was good too because we could speak this. I don't speak Russian, but because he's been abroad, he knows the culture of going out and working hard. So somehow we just, two of us just, tango all of a sudden. All right, so that's good. As I mentioned to you, Akure is located in western part of Nigeria. And of course, this is just a quick statistics on where it is. It's the capital of Ondo State. There are about 30-something states in Nigeria. Ondo State is one of the promising ones there. This population is about 450. Rainforest is climate. And of course, two major seasons. I went there at the right time, I would say. It was dry season. Matan suddenly show up when it looked like it's cool and calm around January, okay? So the Yoruba language, they are Yorubas. In other words, there are many tribes in Nigeria. They are the Yorubas. You have the Edos, you have the Igbos, you have the Hausas. So they are the Yorubas, the original Yorubas, okay? And of course, they speak Yoruba. Somehow I speak Yoruba a little bit. But they communicate with me in English. So, okay. Very highly hospitable people, very friendly people. and very educated people, passionate for knowledge, okay? So this one is high point on my stock. When you go to Nigeria, you run to people who are very serious, whose culture is ethics of hard work and discipline and education-centered people, hey, it just fits into my own way of looking at things. Okay? I just showed this quickly to show you where we are in Google Maps. You can go there quickly and you see FUTA is right here. A very beautiful campus. I don't know, it's like they just sit one day and start keep building new buildings. Very nice building. Very equipped, well-equipped buildings and so on. So they have a FUTA road, Akure Ilesha road, and of course there's Usman Danfodio. These are named after some important people. So anyway, you can also check it yourself. You will see Akure. University was established in 1981. So you know that most Nigerian universities started in the 60s. I think around that time. So 20 plus years later, they spring a lot of universities. Probably about 131 plus universities in Nigeria now. And of course, several of them are federal. And of course, some are private. Some are Christian-based schools as well, Christian-centered schools. So together, I think it's a used to be four universities in the country when I left the country. So that's why many of us had to come abroad to look for a place to go to school, right? But even with 130 plus university, that we cannot, they still don't have enough space for all those who want to go to school in Nigeria. Simply put, I'm saying that maybe less than 2 million people are able to go to the university out of 160 million Nigerians. Or out of, let's say, age group of those who want to go to Nigerian university, maybe more than 50 million. But we don't have enough space for more than 1 or 2 million. So don't be surprised when you see Nigerians all over the world. They're highly educated, they need a place to educate, and they need a place, higher learning place, such as American universities or European universities. I say this because, you know, the population in that school is about 15,000. That's all. 15,000. And you know, some schools in America, you have thousands of people. There are 7 schools: agriculture, heart and mineral, technology, engineering, all of engineering, civil, mechanical, manufacturing, electrical, it's all in within engineering and engineering technology. Since it's a technology university, the word technology will keep up everywhere, okay? So that means it's theory and hands-on. They must produce, not just theoretical school, so that, which is a good one. Environmental engineering, that's where the School of Architecture is located. And of course, you have management technology like the School of Business that we call School of B. That's how we call the School of B, you know? So that's sciences, the chemistry, the physics, the biology, all of this. There's no medical school in a typical Federal University of Technology, but they may have programs that will promote medicine and so on and so forth. Finally, there is a school of graduate study, which means postgraduate, all those who want to obtain masters and PhDs enter or register through that one unified school. We do the same at Howard. There's a graduate school. Available programs, as I've said before, they have a pre-engineering program. Pre-degree program, they call it. Not pre-engineering, pre-degree program. And the pre-degree is for those students who couldn't gain regular admission to the direct admission to the university. So they have to go 1 year prelim. And that one prelim will prepare them and take exam. If they are able to qualify, they can start school. Again, there is also a 5-year undergraduate, which is a 5-year program, not 4 years. And the 5-year includes hands-on training. So they have to take 6 months out for industrial training, where they work in the industry, like a co-op type program in the US, you know. Drexel, Northeastern, they have co-op. So they have an arrangement like that for all of typical Federal University of Technology. They must give 6 months training, so hence 5 years. Followed by that is also a postgraduate program for those students who want to do a diploma degree, a diploma certificate. Maybe they didn't have a chance to go to a regular university, they've gone to a polytechnic, and they want to do more of advanced work. Followed by that is a 24 months master's program. Again, Master of Science, Master of Engineering, Technology, in all of the areas that I've mentioned. Lastly is the PhD program, which typically take up to three to five years, doctoral degree. Again, that addresses challenges that the country or the nation face. Facilities are, as I say, extra modern. and they continue to build new ones, so it's very well maintained. And again, the Vice Chancellor is an extremely committed individual who also had a vision to provide a venue or a lodge for scholars like me who go there, and we have a comfortable place with internet services, wireless facilities. And they have also a computer-based test system facility, a big building where over 200 or 2,000 computers are based, so that they want to have a national exams, or people want to use it for exams that are computer-based. There's such a venue. Medium auditorium, very good library with e-library, a research center, and a good road networks also. You can find your way all over the place. And as I said, there is a broadcasting station and very good access to banking. Here are some pictures I took. They have a FM studio, which is good for their students to manage. And of course, there is a chapel. Oh, I didn't take a picture of the chapel. I had a good time going to their chapel my first Sunday there. I really, really had another blend of the scope, spiritually centered too. So there's a chapel, there's a school, there's a mosque. So you have a blend of all of the above. So that's the stadium, that's the auditorium that is mentioned. And of course, there's the front view of this 2005. And of course, they have a lot of partnership with not just a government university, but there are also other donors from other, like banking, the bank industry, or some other mineral industry that contribute money to the university, or in-kind money in terms of building infrastructure to support the school. The Continuing Education Center over there and the university library, I thought I took a picture sitting there, but it's not showing here. There's a research laboratory where all of the different research groups, like a research center, can get together and do have their workplace. There's also an office space for scholars, international scholars, where they gave me an office. But since I was mostly in the classroom with students or in my bedroom, so I really hardly use it. But I appreciate it anyway. That's the Senate building, a very beautiful one for the Senate, for the faculty. So again, the objective of the program that we went for is to address, there's a research component, there's education component. Fortunately for us, Dr. Adegoke and us, just around the same time this application was being made, we got two awards simultaneously. We got your award, thank you very much. We also got an award from State Department to address a research topic on the area of transmission problem of Nigeria, to look at the electrification of Nigeria, look at the challenges the transmission system has. And so he's going to be working on this project for the next 3 years with his student. So that really, really allowed me to jumpstart a new project while I was there, and defining the objective, the constraints, and immediately we start working. Again, I was able to review the entire curriculum of the electrical engineering department, look at what's good in it and what's bad in it, comparing with what we do here in the US. And I was able to give some advice in terms of practical implementing what I think is also attainable in the best university in America. So giving them best practice. I even introduced to them a day that I set aside for industry day to come to campus. Let's call it a power day. I call it EE day when I was a department chair. That's when I invite all the industry and my students have a show and tell of their capabilities, and show and tell that they do research and they do well. So they're going to start something. I also give them a chance to introduce to themselves an advisory paperwork between the student and the advisor, plan of study on a daily basis, on a quarterly basis. So I gave them some new thinking. Immediately we put it together and type it and say, let's get it approved and start working. So again, I thought our program is scheduled to go more. They wanted me to stay 42 months, right? So before I got there, and once I got there, we have an outline of activity, what I really want to accomplish on a weekly basis, and have a journal of how it is done every day. So I want to make sure on week one that lectures are given. I've already proposed all the series of lectures I'm going to give. I have PowerPointed, I have organized them, and I'm ready to go. Secondly, the training session to train in the different software packages that they will need to do research. And then, of course, visit several offices of the VCs, the deputy VC, the librarian, the computer science director, and the chapel, and so on and so forth, just to be sure that you have a visitor in town. Lo and behold, little did I know that that work week also, or during my stay, was going to be the convocation, a delayed convocation around December. So I had to attend the convocation event, the chapel service, the dedication service. So I really, really think it was a godsend opportunity to be there. Next one is, of course, continue the course, continue the lectures and the training. The training, I will show you the package of training soon. Very quickly, we also inspect the laboratories and put my hands and check what works, what doesn't work, and talk to the technologists and ask, how do you make things work? If this doesn't work, what option do you have? How do you maintain your equipment? You know, all of the different details. Sharing my own experience, how we run the labs in different schools I have been to, and even at Howard, showing them best practices. So that was very good because they saw some few things that they appreciated, and I appreciate it too, that they appreciated it. And also, I have a big seminar on the whole campus. I couldn't believe it, how they pulled it together. I thought they were about to be on holiday break, December, first week of January, for example. They brought everybody back. You will see a picture of some of them. I was talking about smart grid. Everybody wants to know what is smart grid, okay? So then before the end of the stay, we decided to visit the Nigerian University Commission, which is the arm that supervises all the Nigerian universities in the country, which is called NUC. So I was privileged to go there. I was also privileged to visit the Nigerian Transmission Company of the whole country. I have access to this place, so they need access. I also have the key to go there. So we went together. I had a very, very wonderful presentation and exchange data collection for their students so that they don't have to be begging for data to do research. I've already got that for them. So that was good. So here is, for example, part of the training sessions. It's like I teach a graduate program in a hurry. I more like a one semester graduate class, basically, in different topics. I covered optimization theory and its application to power system. That's one of my fields. I have books written on that. The book's expensive, but I was able to share some of them alone. We also cover power flow analysis. Some of my students at Howard were able to provide online training of how to use the package. So that was very good. So they learn. Now they are using it to do their research. I'm so glad this is happening. Okay, next one. We cover reliability studies for distribution networks. Come up with all the indices, CID, CIFI, CAIFI, and all of these different indices, how to gather data for different utilities and evaluate its reliability. Next one, they wanted to learn, so I kept giving them. So probability and fuzzy logic was something else that we were able to deal with and introduce them to some new topics that we are struggling with in the States too, which is called evolution programming technique, adaptive critics. So we introduced that, followed by protection and relay technology and some methods of prediction and forecasting, time series issue, neural network-based approach. Here are students, so I was so glad. Whatever I was doing here during lecture, they were very focused. Maybe one of them, I asked them to go to the blackboard and explain things, and I was also watching what they understand from what I teach. So a group of students, they gave us a nice place to work, so that's a lecture session of all the graduate students of Dr. Adegoke. They were all there. Master PhD student. Okay, again, here is myself, again, maybe giving a PowerPoint presentation with slides. Maybe this is downloaded even between me and my student from Howard, giving that lecture on that day. So this is going on. So these small pictures, again, we have lunchtime. we could, lunch is right there served. So so everybody eat, and we had a good time with chicken, or sometimes, I forgot the food anyway. So we had some food here to eat, some Nigerian-made food. And of course, that's Professor Adegoke and I. And obviously, it was a posted session on one of my lecture time. Very busy writing or PowerPointing at each time. Very quickly, this is my bedroom. Okay, as I tell you, they come, sometimes they don't want to go home. Even myself, don't want to sleep. So on this occasion, this is a master's student preparing for his thesis defense soon. So I say, okay, it's your turn to talk tonight. So he got up, and I'm giving feedback on his presentation, and he's making notes as we talk. So that's me. That's one other PhD student. That's Dr. Melody there. Okay, and not in a given presentation. I reviewed the curriculum, as I mentioned to you. So these are some of the recommendations quite quickly I gave them. One, they need to include some other interdisciplinary courses rather than just pure electrical, because I don't do that pure electrical in my school. I work with the School of Economics. Mm-hmm. I work with the gentleman, lady you showed me, the Professor Green and some other professor in my school. School of Business, because power engineering, for example, this day involves a lot of money, economy, environmental, societal issues. So they need to be aware of this type. So I encourage them to take courses in that. I saw the work in signal processing is not sufficient. They don't do enough. Computer applications to power system is very dry. So we introduce some new courses and for them to get it approved through the dean's office. And of course, I also suggest that which of the graduate students spend at least 1 month in the relevant industry, 1 month, just to be sure they know what's going on, so they know what is what. So it's not just purely theory. Again, I've told you, I have asked them to inaugurate, and we launch it. So hopefully, we'll have the first one this semester, a one-day called Power Day, where they will close everything down, and everybody will think power on the. So as I mentioned to you, these are somebody who is who in the campus. Couldn't list all of them that I visited. Professor Daramola is the vice chancellor. I call him the vivacious vice chancellor. Very, very, very committed person, young man. And thanks to him for providing that leadership for that school. So I only see good promises for that school based on what he has done and continues to do. The dean is also one of the cabinet members who is also committed, Professor Alatiche. And of course, the department head, we have to also work with, and yes, because the program I went for is within EE anyway. So Ola Soji, thank you for his accommodating us. That is the Professor G.A. Daramola. I don't know how to describe him here, but he's one of the best Nigerians I've met with respect to providing leadership in higher education. So it's best because it's not only a good person, good hospital, but has vision for that school. He once put out to be one of the top 10 universities in Africa. That's really the goal. Because he has that goal, I'm committed to work with him. And that's the dean of the school. I visited his office just to say hello and to chat with him and give him feedback on my work. And lo and behold, we see when he trained it pause. My colleague, Professor Melody, while I was there, since it was graduation day, I missed the event, but they came to show me an award in my room. Guess what? He was selected by the university as one of the most productive faculty members for the year. With a little cash, with this award, I was so glad. So receiving with his wife from the provost, from the chair, vice chancellor's hand, an award of productivity and accomplishment. I think it's encouraging. I choose the right person to work with who is also being recognized by his school. That's when they visited me in my room to take a picture with me. Since I couldn't attend the event, I was too busy with students. I didn't think I was invited. Don't say so. I didn't think I was supposed to be there. So I was busy doing my work. But when they finished that day, they came to my room, surprised me with a plaque that this is what I mean. So I'm so glad that this gentleman is recognized by the university president. Okay. As I told you, I inspect all the facilities that I could go to. I gave a major university lecture This is a major one because the topic of smart grid is new in America. It's new in Europe. It's new everywhere. And as one of the leading person in America in this topic, so it is timely that I have an audience who wanted to hear. My book is actually just been translated to Chinese in case you want the Chinese version, you know? So covering all of these materials, people from the, not only from the university came, from the Board of Engineering Registration, from government agencies, they came also to hear this talk. I visited the Department of Computer Science because I see some good things to be done with them in the future as well. That's me giving the lecture on the smart grid, so I won't say too much, I was talking. They were very much attentive to my lecture, so that's the Vice Chancellor and his cabinet. They all came. And don't forget, I'm talking about coming the 6th of January. 6th of January in Nigeria is holiday time. But I need to give that lecture so I can return back soon. That's the group listening to me on the smart grid lecture in the famous 2,500 auditorium I mentioned. I think we did not stop there. We immediately start thinking of how to further, how to sustain this collaboration. They want me to come right back. I said that will be defined later. But meanwhile, we visited TCN to see how we can bring them to continue to work on their research work with them and use the product that will come out of the research. We visited NUC and we visited a PGAM Foundation. Here is me presenting at Abuja. We went to Abuja. I wasn't sleeping there. I was working with them. So there we had a series of meetings in Abuja and where we present their research work and they love it and they want to work with them. So this is TCN director. These are some engineers and me making a host talk and a little book cookie. This is our boss for the higher education in Nigeria. My time is running out. This is Professor Julius Okoji. He's actually called the executive secretary. He's the chairman of the whole place of NUC. The whole country is run, University of Nigeria is run under him. He's the overall boss. So we went to his office in Abuja and presented the project and told him what we're doing. He was very happy. But we asked him if he could fund it. He said, go back to the US. You have money in America. So anyway, but basically, he was a very good gentleman. We went to some outreach to visit some young scholars, young high school students, who had graduated from high school. And they needed to prepare for university or hands-on. Not too far, we have put together, including myself and the family, a place for training young people like that. So we visited such a place. And there we were able to help these kids who are going to be going to FUTA or so many other schools soon. I won't talk too much about this, but it's a lot of promise that you will be aware of later on. It's a foundation which some of us have put together to assist young people in Nigeria. So they use the place to test, to prepare for preparing for examination so they can go to the university. They learn computer-based knowledge. They have ICT training and manufacturing training. Where's my evaluation? Quickly, I ask if we can evaluate the program. I think the success of the future inter-university collaboration for knowledge exchange between Harvard and FUTA, if it continues, that would be good. Two, collaboration with NUC and TCN. Hopefully, quality thesis, quality journal, transcript paper, mandatory, I told them. That's how I will measure the work. I will measure it also quality graduate students. And already I've dictated two of them. One will be coming to Harvard for PhD. One will be coming in July just to finish his master's work and return. I will be mentoring that work. Online every weekend, I'm very busy with the student as I have come back. Skype is free now, so we do a lot of teaching on Skype. These are some opportunities and challenges. I think in Nigeria, you have a lot of young people who are going to change the world. The citizens in Nigeria, maybe 150 million, 170 million, three quarter of them are young people. You have a workforce that the world is going to be tapping into. The workforce, remember, 2020, Nigeria may be the fourth largest country in the world. And we need to do something about that. We believe that lecture will be by distant learning. I may not be able to go every, because I have my own job here. But our free time, we would like to lecture. I think exchange program is already going to start. But we need our students to also go there. So I plan to set up a summer program in FUTA one of these days, which will invite the similar one I do here at Howard, where people will now go there rather than they come here alone. So we'll have a cultural exchange, intellectual exchange. I see problem in the laboratories. They're not very well equipped now. Or when they when they first bought the equipment, they didn't have all the support to maintain. I think because of the funding issue here, I see problem. Funding for overseas-based visiting scholars, and the cost of funding it is not enough. Conclusion and recommendation. I think here is what I just could say in a hurry. I think we really have to worry about several of these issues. You have a copy of this. We need to collaborate more. We need to also make sure that the department accommodates some of the new changes that we recommended, and oversee training for the technologies, not just for the students, not just for the professors, for the technology, so they can have access to the new tech that is going to be imported to them quickly. Because they may have it, but they don't know how to use it. You have sent me. I have gone to talk for you. I have done that. I am back. I want to thank you. For me, it's a good place. It's a good opportunity. I have no regrets one day. Every day, it's like it's not going to be over. I miss my students. I miss my colleagues. But I'm going to be seeing them soon. You, I want to say thank you for selecting me and for giving me the chance. I would have gone to Nigeria anyway, but you gave me a chance to be focused on one project. And nobody could have access to me because I said, I am here for only one thing, the Carnegie Fellow. Thank you so much.